This episode is brought to you by PetVi, formerly known as PetImmune. PetVi is an awesome company from California that makes natural probiotic supplements for cats and dogs. PetVi is a supplement that you mix into your standard pet food to improve your pet's digestive health, immunity, and vitality. Your pet will have less smelly gas explosions, get sick less often, and if you really love your pet, you should be doing what's best to keep them healthy. PetVi's been causing Spartacus and Maximus to hump everything in sight. That's why I use PetVi for Spartacus and Maximus. So for 10% off, go to PetVi.com and use the offer code ICE. That's PetVi, PETVI.com, offer code ICE. Please support them since they're supporting us.
Upon initial contact with Ice-T's music, I had envisioned him to be an ill-mannered and psychologically unstable man with an extremely uneducated and barbaric frame of mind. His raps displayed nothing but ridiculous jargon, shocking sexual audacity, and repulsive images of the ghetto. However, after further analysis of his music, I can deduce that he is the epitome of anti-disestablishment terrorism, who embodies the entire spectrum of the urban experience and struggle. But to make things more plain and simple to the layman, I find Ice-T to be the dopest, flyest, OG pimp, hustler, gangster, player, hardcore motherfucker living today. To be honest, I am totally and completely on his dick.
Welcome to the Ice-T Final Level Podcast, featuring your co-host, Mick Benzo, and your host,
Ice-T.
Hey, yo, this Ice-T, this is podcast number 24. Mick Benzo, number 24.
Oh, man, number 24. Last time we had on our podcast, Tretch, right?
We had Tretch.
This motherfucking week, we got Mobb in the building.
Mobb Deep, this is my favorite rap group, period. People always ask me, they say, Ice, what's your favorite rap group? I say, well, Mobb Deep. And I say that because I get the most out of their music. I like the lyrics. I like listening to the words and stuff. And you could tell a half-ass fan from a real fan because a real fan will quote your shit and, like, break it down and take it into, you know, depths that other niggas don't. So we got Mobb Deep in the house. Prodigy, Havoc.
Yeah, what up, Don?
Yeah. What's good?
They are here.
The full crew, Mobb, yeah, motherfucking Deep is in the building.
Yeah, so I mean,
causing havoc with Prodigy, right? Or Prodigy causing.
You know
havoc.
What I mean? Let me tell you something odd about Mobb Deep, though, that you don't know. There was a West Coast group they know called South Central Cartel, and just by it was like some unknown shit. Neither the groups knew about each other, and one of the rappers' name was Havoc, and the other rapper's name was Prodigy. On two separate coasts.
Wow, West Coast, East Coast. Yeah,
That's crazy.
Mind-boggling.
Mind-boggling.
I didn't know that, though.
And no one ever called each other a biter because neither of them were aware.
Right.
But how do you have the same group, two different groups with only two rappers with the same name?
That's
crazy. So, I'm a fan of y'all niggas. You know that. I mean, we go back. It's so much to talk about. We're just happy to have you here on the podcast. Now, here we go. Number 24. Before we get into news and the atrocities that are sports, let me talk about Mailer Aggressive Strength Testosterone Booster. They sent Mick and I some samples, and the stuff really works. Mick swears by it. So the way it works is, unlike hormone replacement therapy or steroids, the Aggressive Strength Testosterone Booster increases your own production of testosterone by helping the brain communicate with your balls, your testes, to signal greater production of testosterone. In addition, Aggressive Strength blocks the conversion of testosterone into estrogen and improves mood, focus, and ramps up your sex drive big time. This is also all natural, which is very important. So go to www.aggressivestrength.com and use the offer code ICE for 10% off. That's aggressivestrength.com, offer code ICE. The recent shit we've been going through in New York City is some rookie cops shot somebody. Break it down.
Yeah, this happened in Brooklyn, New York, in the Pink Houses. I know Havoc and Prodigy are very familiar with Brooklyn, New York, and the Pink Houses, the projects. They've been known to be, you know, some real, you know, tough people up there, but they had two rookie cops working the beat in the projects, walking the, I guess, the floors and coming in out of the 13th floor, the 12th floor. And the cop happened to have a gun in his hand with his partner and shot a man for no particular reason. How you have two rookies working in an area when you should have officers that know the area more so?
Exactly. I mean, you know, first of all, I think that, you know what I'm saying, they shouldn't have, like you said, rookies working a tough area. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Bottom line.
You can't have a gun?
No, sir. Now, the point is, rookies can work tough areas, but rookies should know the area they're putting them in.
Yeah. I'm the devil's advocate, Mickey. Did you kid have drugs on him?
No, nothing. He had no gun. He had his, what you said, Prodigy had? Who with him?
He had a girl. He was with his girl on the staircase.
So what they was doing in the staircase?
I don't know what they was doing.
You know, none of this, right?
I don't know what they was doing, to tell you the truth. But I know they was in the staircase, and they said that, you know, allegedly or whatever, the police came with the flashlight in the dark staircase, and I guess startled them, and the police was startled and shot his gun.
Said that they thought they saw a gun?
Nah. No. My thing is, if an officer draws his gun, Prodigy, he shouldn't have his finger on the trigger.
Yeah, he had his finger on the trigger,
and at 6 ounces of pressure, he was afraid.
He was
a door opened, and there's no lights, and he just shot. An innocent
Are you kidding me?
Man.
You know what I mean? And it took 5 minutes, you know what I mean, for them to call it
to radio it in. And we already talked about what happened in Staten Island. The big man that they choked out, he was actually giving himself up. He wasn't forcefully doing anything to them.
Let me ask a question. Why do you think the New Yorkers, I mean, I know there's an outcry, but New Yorkers seem numb to this stuff. You know, like in Ferguson, of course, we see the streets is crazy right now. This is the second killing in New York in the last couple of months. What's going on in New York? I mean, I'm just lost for words.
I mean, in New York, you know what I'm saying? We no strangers to, you know, the police brutality or the abuse of their power. You know what I mean? And we know that, you know, protesting crazy and looting stores or establishments, that's not going to change nothing. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So we don't. That's how I figure that, you know, New Yorkers probably don't, you know, go out and protest like that because, you know, hopefully, you know, saying that shit'll get handled.
Well, right now,
We've done enough protesting. Enough of the protesting.
Word.
Officers should be held accountable for whatever the fuck they do, because if me and you went out and did the same incident, we'd be locked up for murder. It ain't no such thing as a mistake. A mistake is not pulling a weapon out and firing it and hitting a man and killing an innocent party unless there was an incident happening. Prodigy said earlier before we was on the mic, he said, "Yo, dog, there wasn't no call, there was no problem. You're just checking the floors of the project. Why would you have your gun in your hand and have your finger on the trigger? Because you're afraid that somebody's gonna grab you."
But listen, the technology is changing. You know what I mean? And there's more cameras everywhere. Soon there'll be cameras in that staircase. Mm-hmm. What I think they should do is, you know, how they got lasers on guns, they should put the cameras on the gun. So anytime an officer pulls out his firearm, it's being recorded. Everything.
Well, Prodigy didn't have it.
On their shirt or whatever.
Don't you think his taser should have been out more so than his weapon?
Real talk.
Yeah, that's
shouldn't
true,
his
man.
Taser come out? Because that taser hits you with so much vulture, it knocks you down too,
I mean,
right?
But that's like bringing a knife to a gunfight. You know, Brooklyn, New York. The cops ain't trying to tase nobody. They know that motherfuckers got guns out there. They like, I'm bringing my gun out. You know what I'm saying?
The rules in the police department, right, they say the procedure is the officer is allowed to use their own discretion depending on how violent they think
but
the situation is going to be.
But where's the aggression that I need to pull my gun?
It's up to the officer's discretion.
Okay, I understand
that,
but where's the aggression that I need to pull my gun out when I'm walking the steps of the project? There was no...
He was just fit.
Let me say this.
These officers be from like Long Island and nice little towns.
I said that. Well, no,
they don't even belong there.
Know your neighborhood.
Okay, what needs to happen...
This is news.
The day that's that.
Oh, let me say this. You know, I'm from LA. And that, you know, 92, they had a riot. The riot was based off of the Rodney King incident. Rodney King didn't get shot. I mean, they just beat his ass and people saw it. People got at us. They say, oh, the black people wanted to riot. They didn't riot when they saw the tape. They rioted it when the verdict came
in. Right,
well, they
right.
they saw the tape. They say, well, this is what happens.
Right.
Okay. But then when the verdict came back innocent, meaning there was no crime committed. Now, you telling me, you tell, wait a minute, you telling me they're innocent and my uncle's in jail for some bullshit. You dig? I mean, that struck a nerve. Motherfuckers like, somebody broke the law.
Right.
You dig? Now we got this Ferguson situation. Now, they haven't, I don't know, maybe by the time this podcast has come out, they might have brought an indictment. All the indictment does say is you got to go to court.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that it says a crime did happen.
That you've been accused of the crime. That's all.
I think what happens is now, you know, when they hear, you know, especially people out there in the podcast, they hear young black people, they hear us talking about the cops and stuff. I want you not to hear the anger, but I want you to hear the despair. Mm-hmm. I want you to hear people saying, come on, man, really? Now, I spent a lot of my life, I thought I was going to be a career criminal. I took thank God I took a career turn for something more legit. But when I was in the street and I was breaking the law, I never looked at the cops as the enemy. They were the opponent. Okay. And if I got caught, I wasn't mad at the cop. I cuff up. You know, now we're going to play law and order. Now let's see if I could beat you. Criminals understand they could get shot, but these are innocent people that are getting struck down the street.
Not
it's not like they gunning,
fair.
They come
they're
up in a
playing fair.
Yeah, they, like it'd be different if they ran up in a dope house.
Mm-hmm.
The dudes had automatic weapons and they got it in. Ain't no black person, nobody gonna say nothing about that. They gonna say, oh, well, these niggas were selling
dope.
Well,
you shouldn't have did it, exactly. Right.
Okay, but when innocent people, kids in the street with their hands up, the guy I saw was selling cigarettes in Staten Island,
right,
they choked
right.
the nigga out on TV. That was like a snuff film.
That's crazy.
Word.
That was a
word.
Snuff film. When you watch that, you're actually watching a murder.
Yeah, word. Take place.
Word.
And now this other kid got killed, man. I think what we're really saying here on the podcast is cops have to be held accountable. It's out of hand. It's gone from beating our ass to, you know, killing us. And like when I was younger, I was in a police car with some cops. This was back in, you know, gangbanging days. I wasn't even gangbanging, but I had on the outfit look. And I'm with my partner, and we're in the car, and we're talking shit to the cops. They taking us down on some bullshit, no ID bullshit. And we like, fuck you, this, that, and the other. The cop offered to pull over and told us if we fight him, he'll let us go.
Wow.
Two cops. They wanted to.
That was a setup to shoot your ass, though.
Exactly. And I was like, at that point, I was like, you know what? Take me to jail, man. Because all they was going to do is pull us over in that alley.
Mm-hmm.
And if I, you know, plus we was kids and they was men, right? So they were supposed to be bigger than the little bullshit we was talking in the backseat of the car. But these motherfuckers really wanted to take us out. And I know I might not made it out of that alley.
They'd have gunned you down.
I play a cop on television, and a lot of times, even on our show, we try to show cops indiscretion and how they get down and do dumb shit and cross it up. That's why I respect Law and Order, because Law and Order shows all the angles,
right.
You know. But I think what we're saying here in the news portion is cops have to be held accountable, and people have to understand that when you hear people angry, It's
more of an outcry. They
it's despair.
Be
it's like,
they
God
be
damn,
held
man.
Accountable for what they have done, just as if we have done it. It's no more, we're going to take you and put you on light duty, take your weapon, give you a desk job. If you made a mistake, remember this, there is no excuse for mistakes in the court of law.
In life, you make mistakes, and that's one thing you have to teach kids. Like, people say, oh, I made a mistake. Can I just say I'm sorry?
I wish I can do that if I go
you
to court. I made a mistake. There is no law for ignorance of mistakes.
Right.
You made a mistake.
You gotta pay
as a
for
rookie.
It.
You pay for it.
That's what we have to do.
Exactly.
All the time.
And that was news. Hey, Hey, okay, this is Final Level Podcast number 24 with the infamous M.O.B.B. Havoc and Prodigy. My niggas, what? And this is sports. Okay, when I say sports, New York niggas get quiet.
Yeah, I must. Man, I must. Listen. Because I am a New York sports fan, and I see my man over there, Havoc, he got on a Nets hat.
You know, I was
that must
in,
be Jersey.
He's nah, born nah, in Brooklyn. Nah,
oh, I was that's born in Brooklyn.
Yeah, I was born in Brooklyn, raised in Queens, so you know, it's validated. It's
yeah, validated. You from Queens, you ain't from Brooklyn right now, man. And put on a Bronx hat or something. We got the Yankees.
I mean, I'm not from the Bronx.
I got some trivia. I got trivia because I know a little bit about them, and we've been shooting in their projects. I bet people don't know actually officially where the Queensbridge projects are, what area of New York that is. It's not Brooklyn. And it is Queens, but it's not called Queens.
It's right across the 59th Street Bridge.
Trip off this. It's called Long Island City. How the hell did it get called
Long
Island?
How you get Queens or Long Island when you're straight across the 59th Street Bridge? You're right there when you come off. That's Marley Marl's building, man.
Right, but am I right?
That's Marley Marl's building, man. Come on, man.
Nah, man. That's true.
That's Marley, baby.
Hold on. Am I right?
You right. But, you know what I'm saying, back in the 1700s or whatever, when the Dutch settled it or whatever, it all was, because Queens is connected to Long Island, it's all one big island. Queens is just at the tip of it, where it lives at. So, I think it used to all be Long Island, and then they, you know, they...
And that's the Long Island City. Yeah, okay, let me get into Queensbridge for a minute, since I'm...
So, MC Shan should have said Long Island instead of Queens, you know what I mean?
When we talk about...
Queensbridge.
When we talk about the Queensbridge projects, right, what is the 41st side?
There's two sides, you know what I'm saying? You got the 41st side, and you got the 40th side, you know what I'm saying? I'm from the 41st side or whatever, you know what I'm saying?
I got a record by somebody. Who's the dude that made the record, the 41st side? Where that nigga saying, syringes, Cartier lenses. Oh. I'm not in this game, I'm in the business.
That's
41st side,
yeah,
right?
I think that's Lakey the Kid he talked about.
Yeah, that's some shit
you know
don't
your
know
block,
about.
You know
I know these
block,
nigga.
Man.
That nigga said, I'm not in the game, I'm in the business.
Yo, you know what's crazy? Because we used to tell him that his voice sound like you.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
We used to tell him that.
You emulate Ice? Like,
yeah.
Like, no, Ice emulating him.
Nah, nigga. I don't change. I rhyme exactly how I talk, nigga. Fuck off. But anyway, we back to this sports shit.
And yeah, you gotta leave my sports team.
I got a reason I think could help y'all football teams out.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, because New York teams, both the Giants and the Jets, actually play in New Jersey.
Oh, so you saying we should change our name to New Jersey Giants, New Jersey Jets,
no,
instead of New York,
no,
or
no,
move
no,
to
no,
New
no,
York?
No. Okay, let's break it down. He's wearing the Brooklyn Nets, right?
I don't know.
They used to be. No, listen. Listen to me, nigga. The Brooklyn Nets used to be in New Jersey.
They weren't called the Jersey Nets then.
They were New York Nets, just like your other teams. Follow my track the movement, right, nigga. Right. Listen, nigga, when Pimpin' starts speaking, man, I don't really waste time with words that's not valuable. See, when they was there, they could not win.
Right.
They came to Brooklyn at Barclays Center, and niggas started winning. Yeah. True to right,
yeah,
right,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah,
so you got to move your football teams from MetLife Stadium. You need a stadium in New York City for the New York Jets and the New York Giants, and I got a place for it. I even figured it out. Put it over there in Queens. Put it right where they used to have the World's Fair.
Right there, yo.
Y'all got space?
It's a band. It's a
we're so dope. We so dope. We New York, space. New York. We need two teams at all times.
Two teams, right? With no stadium.
Hey, we don't care. Look, I know where the Knicks play at. On 33rd Street, Madison Square Garden. I know where the Rangers
Yankees
play at.
Wait.
Yankees play on 161st Street. The Mets play in Queens.
Okay.
We good. New York.
Listen
two
to
teams
me.
For the baddest motherfucking state
listen
out.
Listen to
baby.
Me. Where did the Yankees play?
I play on 161st Street.
In the Bronx.
In the Boogie Down.
And how's their record?
Oh, we loving it.
They win.
Yeah, we got.
I rest my case.
There you go.
New York teams need to play in New York City, and the records will get better.
Yeah, the Giants and the Jets got to come home. They got to come home. The Giants and the Jets, they got
to
come home.
Okay, now, if anybody wants to help me build this stadium, I know MetLife Stadium is going to probably send killers to my door for that goddamn comment.
We got Mobb Deep with us, baby.
Listen, that's a good idea, man.
And that's like right across the street from City Field, like right over there, right?
Yeah, there's a baseball field over there. That's where the Mets play, right?
Yeah, City Field.
You want Mets with a Mets at.
I'm not even from here, and I know more about the city than you do, Mickey.
All right, man.
I'd be around, nigga. I'm from the bubble, nigga. I play the whole bubble, nigga. From the pineapple to the big apple, from the snowflakes to the earthquakes, nigga. When I touch down, it's my motherfucking town. Why?
Because
I meet
City,
the bosses and
the
Bronx.
All teams coming to the Bronx. I meet the bosses.
They move it around for me. You understand? Okay. And that was sports. Final Level Podcast 24. We have a special news bulletin that we going to drop right now. You know, we don't get into gossip. We don't talk that shit. But shit has happened, and I felt necessary to speak on it. Like, back in the day, earlier in the podcast, we talked about Justin Bieber. I was like, Justin, calm your motherfucking ass down. You throwing eggs and shit, nigga. You're not cut for prison. You're not cut for none of that shit you're doing. You're hanging with rappers. Here's a rule to little pop stars. Ready? Don't fuck with rappers. Leave rappers alone. You don't need a rapper as your best friend. You don't need... There's other pop stars. I just heard some pop star just join the Bloods. Initials of CB. But I don't know why on earth you would become a star and then join a street gang, but they are doing dumb shit.
Wow.
By the pound. And right now I heard that, you know, Justin Bieber, my nephew, I call him my nephew because I'm good friends with Usher. You know, and I felt I should say something. That's his artist.
Right.
But, you know, I heard he got a warrant down in South America some goddamn where.
Well, he lives in Canada. They're not going to fuck with him.
Yes, no. When you're famous and you have arrest warrants out and all that kind of shit, they'll come see you. They'll get you.
They got an extradition. Contract to say, if you got somebody over, we'll send them to you.
Oh, no.
They ain't going to do that.
Our police will do their favor of bringing it to.
They're definitely going
to
cut a special deal.
Yeah,
just for Justin.
Yeah, Bieber. Because the police hate him. Right. You know, so they're going to send him that now. Sitting in an Argentinian court or something like that. That's something I watched Locked Up Abroad. You ever watch that?
Hell yeah.
Don't know their language. Yeah. Don't know nothing about it. Why would
they got
I
guns in the motherfucking jail?
Yeah, like, you go in the jail. The niggas got guns in the jail. That's like Midnight Express.
Remember Midnight Express?
Yeah. Okay, so we're not talking about Justin Bieber right now because he's decided he wants to be a gangster, so why don't we just send him the whole Mobb Deep collection of records so he can play them and get tattoos and all that shit. You know, that's his career path he's decided on. But let's talk about this guy, Bill Cosby.
Well, I got a problem, man. I'm not watching TV Land no more, man. They're gonna pull all the Bill Cosby shows.
Oh, man.
When only Bill Cosby being accused of a crime that I don't know if he did after 40 goddamn years.
Okay.
First and foremost, we all grew up on Bill Cosby show. There was a lawyer and a doctor. They were black.
They didn't want us to believe that anyway.
Well, I watched that motherfucker and I thought it was great. But guess what? Uncle Bill loves pudding. He ain't raped no goddamn body up.
Okay, this is what you say. Now let
Come
me
on, have it, have it, have
no,
it.
No, no, let me speak
up. Havoc. Can I get 50, something, man?
He's 50-50, man, with it.
50-50, okay.
Okay, this is my point. I'm going to say this, and I'm not even going to go as far as saying whatever. This is my point. When you play holier than thou, when you play the game where you say...
How did Bill play holier than thou?
Oh, I don't like Eddie Murphy. I don't like Richard Pryor. I don't like Chris
filth,
Rock.
Filth, Lauren, filth.
Yeah, filth. Filth. I don't like, Dave Chappelle. I don't like hip hop. He went as far as to do a whole thing on black people, on how wrong black people are. Okay, this is Dr. Bill Cosby. When you play that game, you better be squeaky motherfucking clean.
Word.
See, now he done stepped in some shit he can't get off his shoe. The comedians are going to have a field day.
Bill Duke said what?
Oh, Bill Duke. That's Bill Duke said move. You know you done fucked up, right?
Hey, look, Bill. Hey, Bill. Uncle Bill. I like pudding too, man. You know, I don't think he did it, man. After 40
years. He was stealing the pudding.
My argument, Havoc, is 40 years later, you come and make a statement that I've done something to you? Why did it take that long?
Well, you know, and then one of the women that are coming out and saying is Janice Dickinson. Mm-hmm. And if you know anything about Janice Dickinson, this bitch wants to be in front of the camera. She, you know, she's the world's first supermodel. Let her tell it. But she's a piece of cake. She's a basket case. Now, she is going to go on a world tour. She's going to promote this. She's going to write a book. Yep. Just one chick like that. Like, she's like, it's like, you know, he fucked Superhead.
She was, she was famous for taking pictures anyway, correct? She was famous for taking pictures anyway.
Right.
So why these pictures didn't come out, again, I got to go back to the number of 40 years later. Why would you, I mean, I heard.
You know what, Mickey, I'm going to tell you like this. This is how I feel about it. You want to protect Bill Cosby. I'm on some fuck Bill Cosby shit right now. You want to go, I'm going to go left. Fuck Bill Cosby. Fuck him. He didn't like, he don't, he's a creepy motherfucker. He didn't like,
I like putting,
he don't like hip hop. He didn't like black, he said black people don't know how to act. He didn't like any of the comedians. My friends, Chris Rock, Eddie Murphy, all them. He had a problem with Dave Chappelle. He's such a perfect person. You know, now he got caught raping. You know, on our show, we don't call him rapists. We call him rapers. So rapers. He's a raper. You know, he's out here slipping. He probably invented the motherfucking roofie. Right. Now, not only the women have come out, but his man came out. One of his men said, yo, I used to watch guard the door and
he wanted to make sure nobody go and bother Bill.
But see, this is the difference. If a lot of women were making allegations about me, that's one thing. But when my man, and then if you, my friend, said, I gotta say, Ice was doing it. You see what I'm saying?
Hey, Bill, I fuck with you, man.
You talking about Bill? Hey, you talking about Bill Cosby? Hey,
come on, Roger, I need some coming out saying all this. Bill, man,
I think, you know, he looked like a creep to me.
Shit.
You know what I mean?
But it's fucked up. But it's fucked up for the other people on the show. You know what I'm saying? True. They pulled the show now.
That's my whole, that's another argument. Why do I not get my residuals? Because you're pulling the show because one person on the show made a mistake. We all have to pay for it.
I agree with that. And I mean, he deserves,
Claire didn't do nothing.
He deserves his day in court.
And I'm not holding him down.
I'm not here to say Bill Cosby's raping. I'm not here to say that. I'm just saying, that's when you talk that holier than thou shit and you got the nerve to come out against hip hop, you got the nerve to come out against all this kind of stuff. Well, you better not fuck around and slip, because now you've created enemies, you know. And I'm pretty sure he wasn't an Ice-T fan. You know, the motherfucker would have his attitude about all kinds of shit, and now you in some shit. So good luck. You know, I would hate for the man to have to go out on his
bad note.
Hey,
Bill, they're just accusing you of a crime.
Hey, you know what?
It's not been.
Hey, let me teach you something, though. My mother taught me when she was alive. She said, you can't unring a bell. So once that accusation has been made, whether he's cleared up or ever, it's still going to be in the back of some people's minds.
Wow. They did it to Mike.
Yeah.
They did it to you too, OJ.
Word.
Oh shit, there you go with OJ. Hey look, OJ was supposed to disappear after he beat that case. That nigga was supposed to go someplace. OJ beat the case.
Yeah, he did that.
Got away with it.
Did that.
A murder.
Did that.
Because I think he did it. But
I don't
then,
think he did that neither.
Okay.
I got
but
you,
when you do beat that case, go someplace. He could have went someplace and been a fucking king of Africa someplace. But this dummy wanna continue to do dumb shit. Jack.
This Bill Cosby
niggas
shit
is stuck
fucking
on stupid
up,
out man, there.
Man. This Bill Cosby shit is,
you know what?
Crazy.
Hey, for the record, Ice-T say fuck Bill Cosby.
Bill giving girls Molly.
Molly, he invented Molly.
I thought that was a rapper's thing that had Molly.
Nah, he had him.
So that means he did
OG.
Like rappers. He did like rappers. He did like rappers. He did like rap. He just didn't want y'all to know because he,
you know. Talking about Molly's, nigga. That nigga was giving out roofies. Whatever. I don't know. He might be guilty.
That
you know what?
Was special.
Even,
news.
Even. If he's not guilty, I'm just happy to see him in some drama because, you know, I'm not a hater, but I might hate that dude.
So the love is fake. And the hate, so the I'm love not, is fake.
No, because I didn't.
And the hate is real.
But give me your grounds for your hate. I got grounds because you got the nerve to diss Richard Pryor.
Right.
You got the nerve to diss Eddie Murphy.
Dope.
You got the nerve to be above Dave Chappelle and all these other
all
great
those
comedians.
Great,
he really,
those are great,
he really
great
dissed.
Ones.
Richard Pryor?
He don't like nobody to curse. He's like Phil. Phil, what do you say?
Phil flying.
And he just he don't. Yeah. So, Dr. Bill Cosby, good luck. Damn, good luck.
doctor.
Maybe the nigga might go gangster and join G Unit. Fuck it.
G Unit.
Bill Cosby.
Bill.
We out. But before we talk about movies, let's take a moment to discuss PetVi, formerly PetImmune. Speaking of family, all of us at Final Level give PetVi to our pets. Y'all got a chance to hear Steve from PetVi call in on the last episode, and I'm here to tell you this stuff really works. I feed this to Sparty and Max, and I know they feel good all the time now because they humping everything in sight. Keeping your pets healthy is something we really care about. It's difficult to do this with just a diet of average food. That's why we supplement our pets' food with PetVi. PetVi is a natural probiotic supplement for cats and dogs that helps prevent your pet from getting digestive disorders, itching and scratching, and excessive shedding. PetVi also promotes and helps your pet's digestive health, immunity, overall health, healthy weaning, as well as skin and coat health. Essentially, PetVi makes your beloved pet have enough of the important nutrients necessary to keep them healthy. With PetVi, being sick as a dog ain't really sick at all. PetVi is hooking up all the Final Level people. So go to PetVi.com and use offer code ICE for 10% off. That's PETVI.com, offer code ICE. Please support them since they're supporting us. Hey, yo, this is Final Level Podcast with the infamous Mobb. And this is movies.
Movies.
Which one you saw? Which one movie you saw?
The Equalizer.
That was shit. That shit is dope. That shit was crazy.
We've been talking about the
Equalizer. That was dope.
We've been talking about the Equalizer for like three podcasts.
Yeah, but it was that dope, though.
And another one you should check out is John Wick. That's with my man Keanu Reeves. It's like kung fu gunfight and shit. Niggas is getting it in. It's crazy. Like, you niggas would see it and do an album called John Wick. Telling you, it's that ill.
John Wick. I gotta see this.
You gotta see it. You gotta see it.
That Equalizer's crazy, man.
It's gonna be the first movie I buy when I get my TV and I'm gonna be watching that John Wick. But then, Pride was telling me about.
Yeah, Insteller.
What is that? Interstellar. What's that?
It's Matthew McConaughey. You know, he plays an astronaut, you know, and they got to go find, like, a new planet for Earth for humans to live on, for humanity to live on, because it's like Earth in the future. There's no food left. The only food left is corn. Yo, it's crazy. You got to see this movie, man.
He's finding a new planet.
So they go off to find, NASA sends them on a mission to find a new planet to inhabit, you know what I mean? Because they got to leave Earth.
Oh, shit.
Now, was it like gravity or it's just different?
Nah, it's different. It's more like a psychological, you know what I mean, thriller, sci-fi, suspense. Like, it's ill, yo.
Now, would people
like
think...
It's like a Twilight Zone episode.
Would people think Prodigy is into shit like that?
If you listen to my, you know, if you're a fan, listen to my lyrics, you could tell, you know, I'm definitely on some metaphysical, you know.
That shit is crazy.
That's why all that goddamn snow's in Buffalo now.
The crazy thing is, Prodigy just gave me Interstellar and then Mariska Hargitay. Now, there's a lot of people that listen to the podcast that are big fans of SVU. This lady is from a whole nother planet than us. You know what I'm saying? She has the joyful heart thing where she takes care of survivors for rape and stuff. She's a really good heart, you know. She's a sweetheart. But, you know, she don't know nothing about the street. She ain't streetwise. But she said go see Interstellar. Mm-hmm. So now I got my Dunn here. He's saying go see Interstellar. That means it's a dope movie because it spans...
Two different blocks
from the hood to the upper west side, upper east side. You know,
they don't make movies like that often, man. It's definitely a dope movie to see.
That's crazy.
I want to see it now.
Must see.
I want to see. So that's a must see from the Final Level Podcast. Mobb Deep. They say go see Interstellar. I will see it in return with a review, and that was movies. Hey, yo, this is Final Level Podcast number 24. We are here with the Mobb, Mobb Deep, my favorite group. Fuck How You Feel. This is my favorite group, and we're about to talk about TV. Yo, okay, there's a show on television. You niggas might not know. There's a new show. Well, it's been on for a while. It's called Drugs Incorporated.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Now, what it is they go from city to city,
mm-hmm.
and they show you the drug game. They go to Atlanta, they talking about Molly. They go up to Seattle, they talking about heroin. They show this. They show the cartels. They show this. They got one on drug submarines.
So what you're telling me is this television show can show me how to make drugs or sell drugs?
Yeah, it'll show you how they sell drugs. It'll show you how to make.
How they get away with some shit like that on TV?
They be
TV.
Cooking crack right on the motherfucking TV. The nigga took the crack.
Yeah, but we say curse words on record. They say parental advisory, but you put this shit on TV and teach us shit.
Well, they teach you in a way. It's like, what do they call it? Investigative reporting.
Right.
You know, so what they do is like, we're about to go inside, you know, this drug lab here with these niggas from Tennessee.
And everybody got masks on their face.
Yeah. But this shit's real. I know
we don't see no faces.
No, you don't see no faces. But it's real drugs.
Wow.
I know real drugs when I see it. So the nigga be breaking up bricks. Like, yo, I got a brick here. Let me show you this. I'm going to throw this in the water. And he put the baking soda and puts it in the microwave. And these niggas is whipping the shit. I'm like, what the fuck am I watching right now? They just showing people how to cook crack. Now it comes out in a pie or a cookie and I'm going to chip this off.
Oh,
and they break it and this is the eighth and this is that and this is half it, and I'm just like,
parental advisory, don't
sit
watch
home
it.
And take notes. Then they show in Drugs Incorporated how they take the coca leaves and they take the coca leaves and they turn it into the paste, and then the paste is worth this, and then the paste turns into.
You still watching shit like this, man? Why are you watching stuff like that?
This is entertainment to me, nigga. I'm not selling no drugs. I'm just fascinated that they will go so far inside. And then they got this one I'm watching where the dude's like, he's selling the drugs. He got a camera crew in the car. And he going like, okay, I'm about to go to my contact. And the contact's masked up. But this is what I get. This is another thing I never got. Is that shit okay? Like, you're telling the game.
And that's what I'm trying to figure out.
That's a form of snitching.
I bet you we couldn't do that in Queensbridge.
It's like they trying to
get the
last.
I bet you if you did in Queensbridge with a mask, they'd be swamped around with SWAT team finding us.
It's like they trying to get the last of the little hustlers out there selling drugs, because they know that's almost over.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? All that hand-in-hand
outside.
That shit
is over.
You know what I mean?
Snitches out there.
It's
going
to be new. The new crime is going to be digital.
Right, internet.
You know what I mean? So it's like they trying to get the last of it. So they're trying to, you know, they want to promote it so they can schedule up the last of these drug charges, get people, young kids in jail, you know what I mean? Before they catch on, like, oh, you can't even hustle no more, sell drugs.
But Pride.
It's like the pressure's on.
Prodigy,
right,
ain't nobody selling nothing no motherfucking drugs no more, man.
No, listen. Niggas,
they
making
weed legal.
No, listen
weed
to me. Listen to me, nigga.
Come on.
All right, now. If I got a drug operation going and I'm out here and I'm the nigga, now I might never touch it. But I'm moving it. It's my money, okay? And somebody in my command chain is on Drugs Incorporated talking. I don't give a fuck how many bandanas he ties around his head. I know this nigga's doing interviews, right?
Right.
This is not okay with me, right?
No, it's not.
This is not a mother. You can get killed doing shit like that. So I don't understand.
We don't talk about Mexico, but the cartels would have been had him out of here.
Don't say that word. That's one thing we don't talk about on this interview. Right. I'm not fucking with Chapo and them niggas down there see me.
No.
They not fucking around the ass.
Mask or no mask.
None of that. They'll send some niggas up here in some cowboy boots and some hats and sit in the big buckles. Them niggas come. Dude, we were talking about this shit, you know, and like in the Drugs Incorporated game, you know. Like, I don't know, I might have said on another podcast, but, you know, those guys from Mexico do.
Right.
Is you call them and you talking about, okay, well, I need, you know, this
just
steak.
Just a key.
They give you 5 or 10.
Damn.
And won't take no money.
So I'll be back to collect.
Niggas is like, I want out the game. Like, right? can I just pay you for it and we be good? Nah. This is what you got now. And we'll see you. And they don't even speak English.
Right.
And they got the cowboy boots on.
That's
you know the
crazy.
Look, the ostrich shit.
Yep.
And it's like, and now you're sitting there with 10 bird keys, like,
yeah, only get rid of one. They want
and they take pictures of your kids on the way out.
Crazy, yo.
Well, anyway, if you haven't watched it, Drugs Incorporated, it's a show on. You put in your DVR. You niggas should trip off of this shit.
Right.
it's kind of like as crazy as the show Mobb Wives. Like is that okay? Like,
nah, I don't think like, it's
who
cool.
okay that?
You know,
nah, it's not.
My whole rap career, I was held on the close leash of dry snitching. My niggas would tell me, nigga, be careful what you say.
Watch
my niggas
say?
In jail. Ice, no, you didn't do that. Speak on, you know. So I was always held within the limits of my reality. Like, they would not, the niggas that I looked up to was like, yo, don't say that. Don't, because niggas is fighting the case. I can't talk too much about a case that people are still saying they didn't do. I'm on TV. Oh, yeah, after we did this. Right, they're like, nigga, what are you doing? You know? So I know that in the life, like they say, a fish wouldn't get caught if he kept his mouth shut.
Mm-hmm.
I had to learn how to...
His mouth closed, can't catch him, right?
I had to learn how to tell my stories. Like, in my book, I said, in the game, people have to learn how to tell stories without implicating those people who might not want that particular story told.
Indeed.
Now, say me and Prodigy was in Atlanta and something popped off, okay? I could tell the same story. It was me and my man Mike in Frisco. I could tell the same story.
In a different state.
But just change the shit. And you got to learn how to do that. You can't just tell. So these shows where these people are talking, dry snitching and shit, really fuck with me.
Right.
Watch it. Try to figure out how these guys got fucking camera crews with them.
Right.
Selling drugs.
I'm surprised the feds ain't on them niggas, yo.
This is what Coco says. Word. Coco says it every night. She goes, that guy is just saying he killed people, and that guy just said that, and they're actually doing this. Wouldn't the cops...
When they gonna come into play?
Because it's not like, it's not like the camera crew and the niggas that's whipping up the crack got lawyer... In client privileges, so the feds could look at that shit and be like, yo, nigga, cameraman, come in for a second. You know the fucking time?
You know how many niggas is going to jail right now off of YouTube?
A lot of that, too. To me, a lot of it, you know, I start thinking it from different angles. You know what I'm saying? I start thinking like they, you know, they did that just to promote, like I was just saying before, to promote that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
To promote how to do it, how to cook up, how to, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
For the little dumb.
Teaching.
Low level.
For the dummy.
You know what I'm saying? Intelligent people, intelligence.
Yeah, well,
level
from the other side, it's a bad look. And that show will promote that's what the kids are in the streets, in every street, and kind of justify the cops and their use of force.
Yeah, don't sleep, because the CIA, they really did that with Ricky Ross.
Yeah. Exactly.
That was
the real
fact.
Rick Ross.
It really
friend.
Did that. You my know what friend. I'm saying? So don't sleep that they won't make something like that up on a Hollywood set.
Yeah, on the scheme of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So those shows, you watch them, but then it's ill because it kind of makes you feel like, okay, you know, the kids are showing the guns and they pointing, yeah, we killers and this, that, and the third. Well, you got to realize that makes America think, oh, okay, these kids are savage. They down here and we got to come in with our guns blazing.
Well, maybe that's why
there
the
you go.
Drug, why the, you know.
Drugs Incorporated, bug off the shit. Yeah, I'm not saying it's crazy. Good. Just bug off the shit. And look at it from a real sense, like, and just ask yourself, is this okay?
That's good.
I mean, is this okay from even a criminal side? It's
not.
Niggas probably in the, a lot of people probably got shot after that show aired. Oh, yeah. I'm on Drugs Incorporated. That's why we're here. Pow.
That's right, why we're right. here.
A word. All right.
Yeah. And that was TV. Okay, Fine Level Podcast number 24 with the MOBB Mobb Deep. My niggas.
Deep.
Talk the Dunn language, nigga.
Yeah,
that's what's up.
We in the building.
That's my shot. That's that shit, Mickey. I don't give a fuck.
No, Mobb Deep is...
No, they real. They real. And you can tell...
And the Queensbridge, man.
You can tell from the conversation.
Listen. I can respect Queensbridge. You know, I know that's Molly. That's Juice Crew area. But I'm going to get that up, man. Them two young guys out there... They decent.
A decent.
No, Jamaica said a decent.
Well, this one is called... This part of our show is called I'm Not a Hater. But I hate shit. Now, haters, we know what haters are. They're envious motherfuckers. You know what I hate, Mick?
What you hate this motherfucker?
I hate cold weather, man.
But, I mean, listen, bro.
Do you like it?
Bro, this is New York. We got four climates. Buffalo got snowed on like a motherfucker. Havoc.
That was crazy.
Did you hear about that Prodigy?
Yeah, they got seven
and he said he don't like
feet.
Cold.
They got
why
seven
like cold?
Feet out
what,
there.
What black person likes cold weather?
Not many I know.
I don't fuck with cold weather, man. I don't like it. I never liked it. When I first came out here to New York, the niggas had on big coats. I thought everybody was bigger.
We had the Woolridge, baby. The Woolridge.
Niggas was looking big and scary and shit. And I just don't like cold weather. I have to work in it. Like, cold is fun to play in. You know, you want to go ski, throw snowballs for a hot minute.
Oh, I forgot. You do Law and Order. Y'all work in the streets when it's cold. I see snow on the ground.
Nigga, we shot at 6 degrees.
That ain't fake snow? Damn. That was real snow y'all was shooting in?
They don't stop shooting movies because of the weather, man. But they pay money, man.
Damn it.
They pay money. Damn it. I mean, you know, there's a lot of things niggas will do for paper. And I have to continue with my legitimate direction I've taken in my life. And one of those is working in the cold weather. It's cold. Like on Monday mornings, we get up. Sometimes we shoot at 7 in the morning. And I'm in the bed. I'm nice and warm and shit like that. But it's amazing what paper will do.
Prodigy would change them 3 years he had up in motherfucking penal to be on the street every day at 6 in the morning. Yeah. Rain, sleet, or snow.
You guys been out here your whole life. How do you deal with the cold?
Come on, Havoc and Prodigy. You know, we don't pay that shit no mind.
Tell it best.
Back in the days, we used to wear thermals.
Two pairs of pants and jeans.
All at the same time. Two pairs of socks.
And they had no motherfucking Timberlands when we were first coming up, man.
Nah.
We wore sneakers with two socks and they were wet when we got in the house.
But you know what else he kept warm? I keep a slug proof underneath my guests.
a lot of ENJ Hennessy.
Oh shit.
A lot of E-double.
No, stop. E-double. We came up on Blackberry. You know what I mean?
Oh, see, that's that old school shit you take when you get cold.
What's
that,
like, all we came up, no, 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 no.
You don't drink that when you're 12.
Hold on, no, Ice told me we don't drink, nigga. We drink the ghetto champagne, Swiss Up and Thunderbird, nigga. It was good,
man. Thunderbird,
we
took
stayed
a lot of
very
out.
Warm.
I'm gonna tell you, I'm more New York than you, nigga. I'm gonna tell you this, right, nigga? This is, let me say, a drink that fucked New York up. Liquid crack.
That's liquid that. Crack?
Cisco.
Oh, man.
That
shit killed niggas.
I got a Cisco story.
That shit killed niggas.
Grab it.
I got an ill Cisco story.
Tell me a Cisco story.
Hold up, tell
me a Cisco story.
The last time I had Cisco.
Oh, man.
Right? I was living in Jersey City. Right? We was drinking Cisco. We was drinking Red Bull. They had Red Bull back in the days, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we drinking both of those. The next thing you know, I woke up, I'm in the precinct.
A what?
At Journal Square, by the PATH train, right? My mom's waking me up. She's like, get up. I'm like, yo, what the fuck? I ain't realize what happened, right? She's like, yo, I'm like, where we at? Like, the precinct. She thought I got sick, because I got sickle cell. So yeah, she thought I had, like, crises or whatever.
Right.
She didn't know I was pissy drunk.
Now, how you gonna yell Cisco over St. Ives, man?
No, I mean,
we were just on our Cisco shit that day.
Come on, man.
Fuck that.
St. Ives?
They didn't even have St. Ives back then.
No. So what happened?
I don't know how I ended up. They said I passed out on the train, and they brought me to the precinct. I don't even know how I got over there, because I was in the crib drinking with all my friends.
I got a Cisco story. We was in the Bronx, and I was with my DJ Evil E, who's a fucking functional alcoholic.
You don't leave Evil. Like, Evil drink like a motherfucker.
This nigga drinks. He drinks shit called Strong Island, where he makes Long Islands with 151. Right. So the nigga was drunk off Cisco. Mm-hmm. I was walking with Busy B,
Chief Rocker,
and KG from
Almighty Rush. KG.
And we were up in the projects, and we was walking, and we're walking by. And all of a sudden, this dude comes out from nowhere and says, yo, you niggas, what's happening? Y'all niggas from around here? Yo, I got an AK here. I know he said, no, I got an Uzi. I'm about to put some head out. Right? So the nigga reached, right? Now I'm gone. Boom, I'm out the hole. I'm down the street. Busy B took off this way. Evil was drunk. The nigga, like, was trying to hide behind, like, a stop sign.
Hey, yo, Evil, we love you, man. Come on, E. Evil the great, baby. Yo.
So then the nigga, KG had ran. Then the nigga, like, start laughing. I ain't got no gun. I'm just fucking with you niggas. And KG was about to bust his ass. Like, nigga, you don't play like that.
Oh, my
nigga,
you KG, lucky,
nigga, I'll fuck you up. And so, but the funny shit, when we all came back in, Evil had not moved. he had just kind of got behind. That's Cisco. That's Cisco. And this happened in the winter.
Yeah, cold again. Cold again.
I hate fucking cold fucking weather. When you say vacation, I say sand. What's that line you talking about? You might kick it someplace, eat, drink.
Drink female drink. I mean, I said sip female drinks, laugh, and get tan.
He said he'd be drinking something with a motherfucking umbrella in it. That's how fly I am. I'm so fly, I'm going to be drinking some female drinks, nigga. Yeah. That's how much I care about you and how you feel about me.
Hey, look, man, for climate weather, New York City, baby.
Hey, that's
York,
what I'm saying.
You hate cold.
Cold weather. I just don't believe human beings are meant to be in cold weather. Human beings have maybe a 25-degree comfort zone, about 70 degrees. If you go to 95, we hot. If you go down to 55, niggas, 50, niggas start freezing. My point is, we need to stay inside of that zone. You ain't going to catch a polar bear at South Beach, nigga. Mm-hmm. You ain't going to catch a lizard on the North Pole. Animals at least know where to stay. Even birds fly south for the winter. But humans decide we can live in any habitat. Right. And that's where they got it fucked up. So whenever I'm on the set, they be talking to me. They say, yo, Ice, man, you freezing? I'm like, yeah, man, nigga, I'm working hard, nigga. I'm a player, nigga. I want to stay in conditioned air. You understand me? I'm doing this shit for luxury. At the end of the day, I've had enough poverty. I'm searching for luxury. No, you know, we've had it hard.
That's right.
Is there something wrong with that? Fuck the cold. I'm not a hater.
But I hate shit.
And I hate cold weather. Before we get into the music segment, let's take a minute to talk about Aggressive Strength Testosterone Booster. As I mentioned earlier, they sent Mick and I some samples of this stuff, and it works. As I said before, there are four stages for an actor. Who is Ice-T? Get me Ice-T. Get me a young Ice-T. And who the fuck is Ice-T? I need to stay in shape, or some young motherfucker is going to take my job on Law and Order so I can dig the testosterone booster. Unlike hormone replacement therapy or steroids, the Aggressive Strength Testosterone Booster increases your own production of testosterone by helping your brain communicate with the testes to signal greater production of testosterone. In addition, Aggressive Strength blocks the conversion of testosterone into estrogen and improves mood, focus, and ramps up your sex drive big time. Good thing Mick only discovered Mailer's Aggressive Strength this year, because he's already had 10 kids. Aggressive Strength builds muscle, helps you lose fat, and enjoy a sex drive like when you were in your 20s by adding Aggressive Strength to your regimen every day. For detailed information and feedback from real-world users and Aggressive Strength nutrition supplement bundles, go to www.aggressivestrength.com today. Be sure to use the coupon code ICE when you order to get 10% off. That's aggressivestrength.com, offer code ICE. Hey, yo, this is Ice-T, Mick Benzo, Final Level Podcast number 24, and this is music.
And guess who we got in the building for music?
The infamous.
The infamous motherfucking Mobb Deep.
What up, what up, what up, what up, what up, what up, what up?
Mobb Deep in the building.
Now, like I told you, Mickey.
Yeah.
I told you, you know, it's my favorite rap group. And that
you keep saying that, like, you know.
Well, it is. And when why I say that is that I listen to the most of their music.
Right.
I can quote most of their music. I felt their music. You know, I'm a big Public Enemy fan. That's my number two. You know, I love Rakim. I love this. But I know the Mobb Deep stuff because with the introduction of gangster rap, see, I was, when I first started, I was trying to rhyme like New York rappers. I thought you had to do it and stuff like that. And then one day I heard PSK. And I was
from Philly?
Yeah, Schoolie D.
Okay, Schoolie, all right.
The shit came on. And the beat itself had a vibe to it that was just different than anything I had heard with the, you know, everybody was off that dun, 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 hey, dun, dun. That shit was like. And I called it dust music. It sounded like you was on dust. And Schooley said, PSK, we making that green. People always say, what the hell does that mean? P's for the people who can't understand how one homeboy became a man. S for the way you scream and shout. One by one, I'm knocking you out. So I'm like listening to this shit. So then niggas say, that's Parkside Killers. He's rapping about a gang in
PSK,
Philly. Wow,
PSK, wow. PSK.
Yeah.
We were just asking a question.
We were just in the car talking about it like a week ago. We was like, what does PSK mean?
It means Parkside Killers.
All the way in Philly, a Philly gang.
Wow. So I'm like, oh, so it was like an anthem for a gang.
Right.
So I took the record and I flipped it. 6 a.m, police at my door. Fresh Adidas squeak across the bathroom floor. And so we make this record called 6 a.m, which a lot of people like say, well, that was the invention of gangster rap. Now,
Who produced that?
Actually, that was produced by myself. Randy Mack had an 808, and we had done one record called You Don't Quit. It was the B-side. Mm-hmm. And you know, I had been saying these gangster rhymes, and then my boys was like, say that shit you be saying. You know what I'm saying? Because I would try to rhyme, but I was making gangbanger rhymes before. I would rhyme shit like shit I was saying was, you know, strolling through the city in the middle of the night, niggas on my left and niggas on my right, yelling, cut, 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 rip, to every nigga I see. If you bad enough, come fuck with me. I seen another nigga, I say Crip again. He say, fuck a Crip, nigga, this is Brim. So we pulled out the Roscoe. Roscoe said, crack. I look again, nigga was shooting back. So he fell to the ground, aimed for his head. One more shot, nigga was dead. Walked over to him, took his gun, spit in his face, and began to run. So if you see another nigga laying dead in the street in a puddle of blood from his head to his feet, I hope it's time all you bitches get hip. That is fuck a Brim, nigga. This West Side career.
So that couldn't fit on a track.
No, that was a gangbanger rhyme.
What year was that?
That's before rap.
But I'm saying it couldn't fit on the track then, on music.
I didn't know about music. I would say these rhymes. I said one in the Art of Rap, a long one. But I would say these rhymes. And when hip hop came out, I was like trying. I said I can do it, but I don't know how to lock it to the beat.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So long story short, I'm making this music. Blow. I make 6 a.m. Another Nick. Then all of a sudden, Cube comes back with Boys in the Hood. Same record. Right. 6 a.m, police at my door. The boys in the hood is always hard. Right. So we all talking off each other. We're moving off each other. Yeah. So I'm just chilling. I'm like, okay, this is this new form. They didn't even have a name for it. I was calling it reality rap. I said, this is just my reality, which is a term I've heard him use. So I'm like, reality rap. And then when NWA came out, they say, oh, Cube said, from a gang called Niggas with Attitudes. He didn't call himself a rap group. So the press said, oh, this is gangster rap. And so I said, well, if this is gangster rap, I'm the original gangster. And that's how the OG shit, it just started to flow. Okay, fast forward. I'm in New York City in the tunnel. In the tunnel. Funk Flex is on the shit. They're checking niggas coming through the door for razors in their mouth. It was the only club that had a mouth search. They going in, bitches gone. Like different shit.
They had a garbage can full of razors, weed.
Okay, I don't know about Mobb Deep. Never heard of them. Don't know shit. I'm like on some shit. I'm in there doing my gangster shit, you know, in New York, you know. And all of a sudden, Funk Flex throws on this shit and it goes, for all the killers and the $100 bills. For real niggas who ain't got no feelings. I was like, what the fuck is this? I got you stuck off the realness. Now, the minute the record came on, I thought I was going to get robbed. I thought immediately my jewels were just going to jump off and shit. Niggas had already told me they're going to buck 50 you ice out there. You finna have problems. I'm like, I ain't finna have problems. I'm good. Because I know how to operate in a criminal environment. You know, I go see the big niggas and befriend them. And I know I don't play gangster. You know, if that's what you are, you ain't got to play it. I'm just cool. I'm chilling.
I remember the first time I met you was in the tunnel. You was walking. You was in there by yourself walking. And you bumped into me. you was like, yo, Prodigy, Mobb Deep? Yeah. Like, yeah. He was like, yo, fuck with y'all niggas, man. Yo, I love y'all niggas, man. I was like, wow.
Now, see, that has to be after I heard the record. Right.
So you knew who he was.
I went and got the shit. I got that whole shit. And I got murder music. I got all they records. I know this shit from juvenile hell. So I'm into it, right? And I realized this nigga was really a writer. I don't listen to rap for the same reason niggas do. I don't dance. I used to break dance and all that bullshit, but I listen to the words. So I start following them, and the shit just gets better and better and better. And I can quote most of their stuff. And we're proud to have them here, you know. That's the business. So how did the group happen?
Man, I'll tell
you. Like, my first year of high school, you know, I had met this dude in my photography class, and he was like, we got cool with each other, you know what I mean? And after about a week, you know, he found out that I was doing music, and he told me he had a friend that rapped too. So he introduced me and Hav, you know what I mean? But his name is Derry. He's from the Bronx. That's the dude that told me y'all was shooting a movie back then.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway.
What's his nickname?
Black.
And y'all talk about him on the record.
Yeah, Bliggity. Call him Bliggity Black, you know what I mean? So one day he was like, yo, me Hav, yo. Hav is nice. Y'all both like the same height, you know what I'm saying? Y'all would look ill in the group together. Y'all meet Hav, yo. I'm telling you, y'all niggas gonna click. So he introduced me to Hav, and we clicked right away, you know what I'm saying? Our grandmothers was like from the same projects in Queens, you know, and we just clicked right away, you know what I mean? I was feeling him and his friends, you know what I'm saying? They was feeling my vibe, and then we just started making mad songs and took it from there. But it started in high school on design in Manhattan.
Okay,
that's
where
I met.
So what got me the most in the Mobb Deep, of course, was the words, but it was the sound. And like I say, when Schoolie D got me, it was the sound of the production. And I always had a problem writing, you know, hardcore, scary rhymes or different things, because that's where my head is. I watch horror movies. I'm into dark, crazy shit that really a lot of people can't stomach. You dig? That's just me. These niggas know. They like, ice is ill. So I hear the music, and the music just sets you in that place. Like, now, you didn't start producing the records till the second record, right?
Pretty much, because like on the first album, and you know, I tried my hand at one or two tracks or whatever, but you know, I wasn't really producing, you know what I mean? But once that first record, it didn't do well, we got a second chance. We was like, fuck that, we're going to take the matters into our own hands. Mm-hmm. Niggas was charging too much for beats. P. Grandma's bought some equipment for us, you know what I'm saying? God bless her, you know what I'm saying? She seen our grind, and she bought us equipment, you know what I mean? So, you know, I already had the passion in me, but if it wasn't for his grandmother, you know what I'm saying, buying that equipment, you know what I mean, you know, the infamous album, you know, I don't know where it would be. But bought the equipment, we both learned it, you know what I'm saying, and I just really was compelled to it, and, you know, I just did what I had to do, you know what I mean?
Now, where did you come with that sound? Because the sound is different, like, the sound is scary, the sound is dangerous. It matches, you know, whatever they want to call it, the gangster rap, the hardcore rap that we do.
Right.
Better than an R&B record, you know, or something. Mm-hmm. And what made you go in that zone?
Because, you know what I'm saying, where I come from, you know what I'm saying, where I live at, you know what I'm saying, the sun don't shine out there, you know what I'm saying? Shit is fucked up, you know what I mean? So only what's in you is going to come out you know what I'm saying? You're a product of your environment, you know what I mean? So that was the sound that was just coming out of me, like dark sounds. I didn't want to hear no happy shit. I just wanted to, you know what I'm saying? I wanted it to reflect on what we was going through and what we doing, who we really was, you know what I'm saying? And still are.
Well, what made us different during our time, we were like the young kids in that era, growing up in that era. You know what I mean? We were like the young kids out of our peers that was rapping. You know what I mean? We was like the young, wild ones.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what made us different. Like, you know what I'm saying? People, I think that's what people were like attracted to.
The only other group, there was a group out of Harlem.
You know you're talking about
Pretty Tony.
Mobb Style.
Oh, yeah.
And they used to roll with AZ in them.
Mobb Style.
So
Those were drug dealers. Those were drug dealers, not just rappers. They talked about the
this
game.
This is what
that
I'm saying.
In, you know what
but
I mean?
How do I know about Mobb Styles? Because me, I'm searching out that type of music.
Yeah,
I'm like,
yeah.
Right. And like a nigga that's been through it, I can tell if you're full of shit.
Right.
You know,
right.
Because because you never talk about the pain that goes along with it. So. You just talk, like I say, and OG, that invincible shit don't work. I throw you in the joint, you'll be coming out feet first. You are not telling me the whole story. Like, he always refers to his pops. It's kind of like, if I'm going to tell anybody about the game, I'm going to tell you about the ups, but I got to tell you about the lows, man. Mm-hmm. The shit is not all good.
Yeah, it's real.
It's not all good.
It's crazy.
Now, speaking on all good, you did your bid.
Yeah.
How many years you did?
I did 3 years.
Just recently.
They sent me 3.5. I did 3 out of it, though.
So you're still on probation now?
Nah, I did 3 years, and then I came home, and I did 3 years parole.
Damn.
But
it just seems like yesterday, because I seen him before he went in. Him and Alchemist was rolling through the village. I said, what's up? And then he caught the charge, you know, basically went in. I was like, damn. But, you know, hip-hop, they don't give a fuck. They like, oh, okay, you gone. They don't care. They rich fucking fans. You know, they're not there with you during the bid. Right. They just fans. It's come out. I remember when Mike Tyson went to jail, he told me, he said, I hated the fans at the time because they just wanted me to come out to fight. They didn't want me out as a man. They just want to see me. I'm just there for their entertainment. I want somebody who wants me home.
Right.
Versus, I wish Prod could come back and make some more records. Like,
Let him come home, man.
Yeah, get out of there. So after you did that time, did it change the way you wrote?
Yeah, it definitely taught me a lot about, you know, just patience and just being careful, more careful of how I carry myself in the world, you know what I mean? Because right before I went in, I would be like a little troublemaker, you know what I mean, in the industry. Like, I was real competitive, and I was real protective of Mobb Deep. Man, anybody try to say something slick in rap music or try to violate us, I'm going at you full speed ahead. Like, that was just me, like, you know what I mean? And I was very, like, you know, opinionated and outspoken about, you know, just my way of thinking, like, you know what I mean? So I had to learn that, you know, when I got locked up, I had to learn, like, you know what? I was doing a lot of crazy shit that was detrimental to the business of Mobb Deep, like, you know what I'm saying? And my life, he put my own life in jeopardy. I also sat in there, I thought, like, it could have been worse than 3 years. It could have been, you know, I could have killed somebody with that gun, or they could have killed me in the shootout, or, you know what I'm saying? I could have been doing life instead of 3 years, or, you know, all the crazy stuff that I did growing up, you know what I mean? I could have got caught for that instead of getting caught for this bullshit 3 years. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
3 years is a long time. Most niggas can't do a weekend in jail.
Nah.
It's a long time to be locked up. I mean, I tell a lot of people, I say my music is post-prison music. Like, you need to go to jail first to understand what I'm talking about. Like, if you ain't never been to jail, you might want to listen to that invisible gangster shit. Listen to that.
Right.
When you come out, my shit'll make sense. Like, it's mature, you know, and that's what it probably did to you. You know, maturity is the accumulation of negative things.
Right.
You know, when you're young, oh, everything. She loves me. Oh, I'm in love. Your older OG be like, yeah, we'll see. Oh, they gonna give me all this money, you know, because you're so eager and you just don't know.
Right.
Life, and as you get older, you become more calm and you go, we'll see. Like, people always tell me, they say, well, what's the difference between the young Ice-T and the old Ice-T? I say, well, the young Ice-T was, I kill everybody. And the new Ice-T is, you know, I kill you, right?
Very calm and cool.
Yeah. So it becomes, and I think I feel that in you. It's like, it's like we not, he. What I'm saying, I'm serious about, but that's all I'm going to do.
Is it just a certain way that I got to carry myself? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was being real rough around the edges with young, how I was carrying myself. Young. You know what I mean? Young, yeah, bro. I was young, and young, still bro. Learning.
A lot of energy.
Being
of
in
energy.
That prison and getting my life snatched from under me, it really sat me down, made me think about everything.
Sometimes people you know say prison saves their life.
Yeah, because I never really had no, we never had no time to think. We've been doing this since we was 15, 16 years old, on tour, on the road, moving and shaking in the studio, just everything happening so fast. We were successful when we got some success. It just started happening fast, and we just living with tunnel vision. All I'm thinking about is Mobb Deep, the next album. Like, who this? I don't care about that rapper. Get out the way. Exactly. Mobb Deep. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so it's like I had to learn how to refine that energy, that passion I had in me, and make it more projected more into a positive direction that can help to increase the business of Mobb Deep.
Baby.
Mobb Deep, when you were, get my timeline straight. Were you in when Chris passed?
No, I just came home.
Yeah, now I'm talking about Chris Lighty. He's a friend of the family. I've been knowing Chris, you know, mostly my entire career. He was a Zulu, Violators up in the Bronx. He was their management. And I would always, every time I see him, I'd say, yo, send my regards to Mobb Deep and this, that. And they're like, oh, I got to hook y'all up. I said, they busy. You know, and one of the things about me as a friend, I like to be considered more of a friend than a needy nigga. You know, niggas like, I, you know, Dre, why Dre never produced a beat for you? I'm like, he's my friend.
Right. You don't have to.
He's my friend. It ain't always got to be business. Right, Even though I did say, I'll say this now, niggas been asking me, we put out the new Body Count album, and it's called Manslaughter. Got hits on it like Talk Shit, Get Shot. It's gangster shit done over metal, which I've been doing since 92. Something else I enjoy doing. And we came off tour, and people are like, you going to do another rap album? And I say, you know what? I'm not really motivated. And one of my lacks of motivation is just I can't really find producer that can give me the sound. Like, I'm making a horror movie. I'm dark. I'm in some other shit. And I said, the only way I could actually do it is if I had, you know, Alchemist and Havoc and Mobb Deep produced the shit. You know,
you
I would go in.
So I can test
it. I would go in.
I'll be the same way, man. I'll be the same. It's hard for me to write. It's hard for me to come from, take this pool of production that's available out in the world right now and pull something dope from it. It's hard for me. Because I'm so used to have beats. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And I'll be like dark beats. Like, I'm spoiled. Like,
I would want to do a bundle of records because I don't really necessarily think I could, you know, like things like, let's go do a song. I heard you niggas with 40 Glock. I heard, I don't know. I don't believe that. I'm like, out of 12 records, maybe one will be the shit. You know, it takes a lot of work to find that shit.
Yeah, I mean, listen.
But, like, you know, maybe we can talk later. My shit is dark, though. And I know y'all are dark. And a lot of stuff I want to rap about, I be seeing the producers go, you finna say that? Like,
does that match this?
I don't give a fuck.
Did that shit run? I know, but you gotta be in a god I don't give a fuck zone with people. Like, if I'm making a horror movie and I say, look, the nigga takes the pitchfork, sticks it in the little girl's chest, and throws the bitch on the lawn. Somebody says, huh? I'm like, well, you're fired.
You know, the artist that you are. Yeah. That's your artwork.
If I can catch you feeling uncomfortable,
you're out the room.
Yeah, so I've been working with like a lot of metal niggas because metal don't give a fuck. Right. Like Cannibal Corpse. You know, they got records like Necropedophile and, you know, Hammer Smash Face. And I mean, their shit is ill, you know. Yeah. And then I work with Chris Barnes from 6 Feet Under. I did a record called One Bullet Left, which is just way out. And there's no limits over there. You can do it. You know, hip hop is like, you know, you're going to get in trouble. So that's why I do BC. But, you know, now I'm looking at you now as like mature artists. The game has changed. You know what I'm saying? Do y'all feel old school?
Man.
My gray, I'm getting these grays in, man. Wow, everybody telling me I should use just for men. That conversation alone makes me feel old school. Wow.
Veterans.
Yeah. Vet.
Veterans. Classic. How many albums is Mobb Deep had?
Shit, like 5, 6.
More than that. I mean,
well, counting the Prodigy, the head nigga in charge.
With solo albums and Mobb Deep, probably about 13, 14, maybe.
Yeah. It's a lot of music. It's a lot of music, and it's good music. And Prod just pushed me this book. What's this book?
That's a novel that I wrote. It's a short novella, like somewhere along the lines of like a Donald Goins novel. I made it short so it's easy to read, help inspire young readers or whatever. It's not a big, intimidating book, like, you know what I mean?
Well, you wrote another book when you just came home. What was that book?
That one was an autobiography. That was more about my life, my family history. You know what I'm saying? This one is straight fiction.
It came out around the same time I dropped the book. And I dropped the book, Ice-T, Story of Gangster Life and Redemption from mm-hmm. South Central to Hollywood. And they, like, Prodigy dropped the book. I didn't get a chance to read it.
I got to check yours out, too.
But it's like... Everybody that read your book was like, shit's dope. You got to read it and shit. Because it's honest. Right. You know, honesty. But now you're writing this. Now, see, nigga, when niggas start writing novels, that turns into screenplays. Mm-hmm. And that turns
into... Well, I'll say, as a rapper can make a book.
Yep.
As a person that can speak can make a book.
Yeah.
Martin Luther King could have made a record instead mm-hmm. of a book. Malcolm mm-hmm. could have did a record instead of a book. Because that's called poetry, man. And if you're good on rhyming, we go into the rhyming, you sure enough should be able to make a book.
Well, that's
and
they need to understand. Some of these niggas out here can't even make a sentence.
Oh, shit.
Some of these niggas that's rapping right now can't even talk. I don't even know what the fuck they saying. Niggas sound like they got motherfucking like ice in their mouth talking.
Yeah.
They whoop blah, this one, so.
Get left down.
I'm like, you know. One of my favorite rhymes of hip hop is Chuck, and that nigga says, "I don't rhyme for the sake of riddling." I was like, "Huh,
Chuck?
I'm not just saying no rhymes, you know what I'm saying?" So you got Prodigy writing books, right? You got Havoc.
So look, can we get a record? Can we get a record from Prodigy? Can we get a record?
We got all. I'm talking, nigga. When Pimpin' is talking. Please don't interrupt me, man, during my
I need
flow.
A record from Prodigy on the podcast.
We
right
got
now.
Records. I'm trying to get to it. Can I get to it?
Let's get
black
to it.
Black ass nigga who fucking hit the motherfucking eject button, but we're not going to talk about that.
Let's get right to it.
Okay. So we got the book here.
Right.
Head nigga in charge. I know what HNIC means.
Yeah, I collaborated with this writer named Steve Seville.
Mm-hmm.
He's from over in England. He's a fiction writer out there. So I kind of collaborated with him just to get the, you know, cross promotion of our fans, you know what I mean?
The niggas writing novels.
Book.
Then you got the new Mobb Deep infamous album.
Yeah, that just came out. That's our first self-titled album in our career, you know what I mean? And it actually came out on the 20th anniversary of the making of the infamous album. So we put 10 bonus songs on there.
So how many songs on the CD?
It's like, on the album, it's like 14, 15 or something like that.
24 yeah. songs?
And then there's a 10-song
so
bonus
like
disc.
24?
Yeah, something like Damn. That.
Where could people get this?
You can order on Amazon. You know, you can download on iTunes. You know what I'm saying?
I'm getting. I think I just downloaded. I was downloading stuff. I got the coke, the black cocaine shit. Yeah. You know, that's got my shit, Dead Man's Shoes on it. Right. That's like some of the illest. I seen the video to that.
Yeah.
See, that's that shit. Niggas is scared to do
that.
That
shit is hard. That shit is hard.
Another
24
thing.
Songs.
Yeah. $9.99. I keep
on
praising
$9.99.
I keep.
They can
praising,
afford that.
I keep praising that. Mobb Deep for another reason is I know niggas that make records that they know can't get on the radio. You know, that's art to me. When everything you do possibly get on the radio. I'm like, come on, man, be serious. You know, I like Quiet Storm and all those records made it. They cracked it, but then that wasn't their format after it. They just said, we keep making this mob music for our fans. Right.
We definitely stick to our guns, man. You know what I mean? Stick to the formula.
Got to. Mm-hmm. Havoc got a new record out.
Yeah, called 13 Reloaded. It's like a part two to this album I put out last year called 13. And, you know, they could pick that up on hclassentertainment.com. Word.
And then we got this Prodigy record right here, the Einstein shit with Alchemist.
Yeah, Albert Einstein. That's my new solo album.
Why did you name it Albert Einstein?
My first, my government name, my first name is Albert. You know what I mean? And Alchemist is a scientist, you know what I mean? So we like, all right, Albert Einstein. It just makes sense. Like, you know what I mean?
Ever thought this nigga's real name is Albert? My real name is Prodigy. Tracy. I got a girl name. When I was little nigga, you say, yo, that's a bitch name. I used to meet niggas and have to fight the first minute I met them. Like, goddamn, you nigga, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, I'm a boy named Sue, okay? Fuck you. But, yeah, I got, you guys brought me a lot of dope shit. I know I could just talk to y'all niggas. And you know, the thing of it is, niggas listen to this podcast like, oh, Ice-T, you on Mobb Deep's dick, this, that, and the third. I'm like, nah, nigga, real niggas have no problem giving props. Real niggas have problems with that shit.
It's all love, man.
And there's a reason. It's because I like the writing, I like the context, and I listen to the music differently than the average rap fan.
All right, enough of this Ice-T shit, man. I want to hear a Mobb Deep joint right now.
Oh,
man.
Yeah, okay, well, look.
I want to hear a Mobb Deep joint right now.
You know what?
Man.
I was just zoning, nigga.
Yo, yo,
Let me pick a record.
Can I get a record?
Let me pick a record.
Yeah, let me pick a record.
Ice pick the record.
I'm going to pick a record. Okay. All right, we're going to pick an old one. Okay, this is one off the Blood Money album. This is how much I know they shit, nigga. The new album is the Infamous album. We'll play that later on the way out. Is that cool?
All right.
The old one. They took a record from Wild Style.
Come on, not the fucking movie. You done lost your mind.
And it's this ill loop, and these niggas took it. I think Alchemist did it, right?
Yep, Alchemist
looped
did that.
The shit, and the record is called Infamous. And this shit is hard body.
Well, check this out on the Final Level Podcast with Ice-T, Mick, Benzo, Mobb Deep is doing right now.
Yeah.
Infamous.
Yeah.
It's like a thing. My mama. Thank you, baby, for cutting me out. Sorry, ma. I know it was hard. Look what you did, though, man. And it's popping now. Smell like money. Smell like millions. Just when you thought it was safe to come out. Infamous all in your face and your mouth. That's right. Best to stay up in the house whilst we getting our money for the 2000. Pee back out in the street. So what now? Strictly for the ghettos and hoods. In your town, probably got bundles of in your town. Like, remember me now, Queensbridge. But we blow your house down. We the big bad wolves that eat your food, clown. I ain't got a huff and puff, you know my style. Calm as I just let my well out. I got cash, I could have you touched. But I'd rather be hands on with that, son. Certain things you just gotta perform yourself, son. When I stop, I don't stop till I hit it.
Everybody got gangs, everybody got clicks. But they ain't like this.
And Infamous.
Everybody can't afford to live the lifestyle of the young black and rich.
And Infamous.
You ain't crazy, don't make me show you why they call us this.
And Infamous.
We own the streets, who basically control this rap.
We got the most gangs, second most biggest projects. We sold the most since 86. Don't handle a lot of, but we the most thug. Think we dirty over there, but we more dirtier. We last more longer than them, more songs than them, more money for us, more bras than them. We get the most love in the streets. I had the most tattoos ever since 13. P got the most now, I got the most lab with enough to damn mostly the whole crowd. We drink the most head again, me and Jay smoke the most. And that's mostly the head you get the most symbols. Kicked on the face, gotta be the most idiot on the face of the earth that ever let the door cross your head. That we not the most likely to pop off, kid.
Everybody got gangs, everybody got clicks. But they ain't like this.
And Infamous.
Everybody can't afford to live the lifestyle of the young black and rich.
And Infamous.
You ain't crazy, don't make me show you why they call us this.
Infamous.
We on the streets, who basically control this rap.
Right now I change with the seasons. When I was young I bought ninja stars on Jamaica Ave, hitting trees then. Started hitting trees then. We ran it on the girls in my family dance school. We was beasting, little young heathens. I had the Rambo knife, and when I got my first, and I was cheesing, I couldn't believe it. I had the power of life or death in the palm of my hand. Feeling for people to be scheming. They choose to front on me, then they leave me no choice to start squeezing. And hope they stop, cause if they do pull through, in them hospital beds they be squealing. Talking to the D's, man, they don't waste no time. They want answers even if you still bleeding. Homie, I'm on the fleasy.
ain't got time neither. I'm getting money off this. It's too easy.
Everybody got gangs, everybody got clicks, but they ain't like this.
And infamous.
Everybody can't afford to live the lifestyle of the young black and rich.
And infamous.
You ain't crazy, don't make me show you why they call us this.
And infamous.
We own the streets, who basically control this rap.
That track was hard.
Come on, man. From the Boogie Down Bronx, man. Wild style.
That's stop.
You gotta, wild style,
you gotta
man.
See the video.
With your Chief Rock and Busy B up in there, man.
Video.
Come
is
on,
crazy,
man. Now, the video. You know I know, baby.
The video. There's a video to that?
Yeah, it's X-rated video.
Is it on YouTube?
Yep, it's on YouTube. Go check it out on there.
Oh, shit. Okay,
we shot it at the Super Bowl party we threw. Had a bunch of girls. It was nice.
Hey. You know what? It's great having you guys here. You know what I'm saying? And we could talk for hours and shit. But now, having you know he got a job to do is make ice and beats so he could go in. And,
oh, shit. Yes,
I
sir.
Definitely was scared. And the name of the album's going to be called Fuck Bill Cosby. He's a raper.
Hey, look, I like Putty.
He's a raper.
I can do a whole album, Bill Cosby. I'm watching I Spy. Bill Cosby sneaking hoes out the back door, hitting bitches with roofies.
Uptown Saturday
knew
night.
What they was for.
Uptown man. Saturday night.
Oh
damn,
my good.
Lord.
You got to think of
damn,
all them.
Bill.
You got to. Damn, Bill.
I got it.
Damn. Fat Albert.
Hey.
Word.
And that was music. Okay, yo, this portion of the show, this is the philosophy segment. Philosophy is brought to you by Final Level, at Final Level, and this is a daily game. It's what I usually do to try to help save your life. And this daily game came from Jim Jones, rapper from the Dipset, a friend of mine. He basically said in one of his records, the love is fake, but the hate is real. And I tweeted that out, and a lot of people were like, damn, Ice, what does that mean? And I was like, you know, it's very rare when you find somebody that loves you. You know, love is something that's deeper than just those words. You know, like I said, your friend ain't the nigga that'll party with you. The friend is the nigga that'll help you bury that body.
Right.
When shit gets fucked up, that's when people that love you feel it. When you're sick, people that love you feel it. And it's very few people, maybe your family members, your daughter, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
But the hate is real. People that hate you want nothing but bad things to talk, to
oh,
do.
For sure. Yeah.
What did you say about haters?
I said, oh, shit.
It's definitely deep-rooted hatred out there, man. A lot of people, man, you know, it's crazy. The hate is crazy, man. You know, the jealousy, the envy, like, you know.
Nah, the hate is actually real because they love to see what you're doing. As soon as you fall, they're loving it. They're like, God yeah. damn, that should have been me anyway, dog. That yeah. nigga shouldn't have had that fucking spot. You know why? Because I'm better than him and nobody know who I am. And you know, the hate is definitely real.
Now, I was listening to one of Havoc's records, and he was speaking on, you know, like, you know, you just came home and you feel some kind of way about me and I took 10 years. What record is that?
That's Speaking So Freely.
On the new album.
Yep. No, that was on, that was on
Blood Money. Blood
that's
Money.
On yeah. Blood Money album too.
Yeah, Blood Money.
And build on that.
Like basically, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes you'll have some friends that might, you know, go do a bid in jail and shit like that. And, you know, maybe they was aspiring to do what you do or whatever it is. And when they come home and seeing that you up, you popping, you successful, you know, they feel like they the ones that's supposed to be in your shoes. So instead of just embracing your success and trying to, you know, be in your circle to try to see what you did, they rather just be in your shoes, knock you off completely.
Mm.
Like, fuck you. You know what I'm saying? And you know, fuck them kind of niggas. You know what I'm saying? I don't feed into that. You know what I'm saying?
The hate is so crazy. You know, like when I'm having a bad day, I just feel like haters are jacking off. Like they want to see. You know, they happy. Ooh, Prodigy went to jail. Ooh, yeah, fuck him. And it's sincere to them. They hate you to the grave. I even say niggas will hate me when I'm gone. Like when I'm dead, they be good. You know, they party on that.
Right.
And the internet, the way I deal with the haters is like, you know, I feel you're insulated by your fans. You got people out there that really love you, whether it's your family or your friends, and they insulate you. And on a daily basis, you wouldn't really have to deal with these haters. You know,
right.
Deal. The internet just allows any clown to say anything to you. Like I tell you, Mick, the internet is like if we put you on a pedestal in the middle of a parking lot and say, everybody tell us how you feel. How do y'all feel about Prodigy? Oh, he's a sucker. Oh, he's the dopest nigga in the world. Oh, I think he's handsome. Oh, that nigga. Anybody can say anything. And I think that two-way conversation has never been, we've never been capable.
It's so petty. It's so petty right now. They like, they comment on your outfit. Like, oh, he had those sneakers on for the past 10 Instagram pictures. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
what well, man
you
said, does that?
No, no, Prodigy said it best. He said, in the penitentiary, brothers that are locked down tend to feed off of you, telling they homie, yo, that was my son, nigga. That was my man. You know what I'm saying? Yo, fuck that nigga. If I was there, he wouldn't do this. He wouldn't do it. Why are you hating?
I dealt with a lot of that personally because, you know what I mean? I came around, had, started hanging around, had back in the days. I'm not from Queensbridge, you know what I'm saying? But I've been out there a lot, you know what I mean? I went to day camp at Queensbridge, whatever, whatever. But then I met Hav, and he, you know, I started hanging out with him and his people, and that became my crew.
Right.
Like, this is the team. Like, this is the squad. Like, we riding for. And a lot of dudes, you know, they would get, they would be, they see me when I first came around, and then they would get locked up, and then they'd come back like, we owed them something, or I owed them something, or P ain't that, P not from the projects, I'm that nigga, but P talking about my life. Mm. Like, come on, dog.
But just to clear something up, though, real quick, though, because, you know, I got family that, you know, did penitentiary in life, and, you know, P did, you know, his bid. Not everybody in the, you know, penitentiary system is haters, you know what I'm saying?
Not at all.
Exactly.
We got a lot of,
everybody, you know, not saying, the same.
Good brothers in there, but, you know, just a select few of, even if they not in the penitentiary.
I got niggas in the joint right now. A lot of my friends are doing life. They got a term in L.A., Cali, they call the LWOP.
LWOPs.
Right? Life Without Possibility Parole. Mm. And they tell me, I'm so Ice nigga, you the only cop we be in here cheering for. You know? So they watch the show and you know, whether they in their own cell or in the day room, yo, Ice, that's my nigga. So you, that's the nigga, you know, because the stories and my friends that really were with me, they, nah, man, leave that nigga alone. There's a reason he's here.
Right.
You know, he's the reason he survived. That's my man. So, yeah, they're living through me, but they keeping me up. They like, yo, no, that's my nigga. And we touching them. You know how much money we send inside the penal system. Shit, but hatred is weird, but it is real. And you have to be cautious because some people have bad intentions.
Yeah, it's a dangerous thing to be playing with, man. You know what I'm saying?
So the philosophy for this podcast is, I'm not going to say all the love is fake, but most of the people that say they love you, that's just a word. You know, I love you. I love your record. Right, I love your music.
Right.
I love that movie. But really love you?
Right.
Your kids probably love you. You know, your wife probably loves you. You know, maybe your close boy loves you.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
But all that rest of that love is fake. But the hate is definitely real, and keep your eye on that shit.
All day.
And that was philosophy. Okay, right now it's time to open up the phone lines. We got Mobb Deep in the motherfucking building.
Yeah.
M-O-B-B. Who's online? Who wants to talk?
This is Matt.
Matt from where?
From Orlando, man. I didn't know it was me. It's a good thing to talk to you, man. I just wanted to say hi to Mobb Deep and had the Infamous back in the day. That was a good album back there. But I just wanted to tell you as well, Ice, like, you've been an inspiration, right? So once upon a time, Depths of Hell spoke to me. So I just wanted to thank you for that. I watched Iceberg Slim last night on Netflix. And if anyone hasn't seen it, they can watch that. I was just going to say that. And then finally, I was going to say, sometimes I quote your lyrics, right, in my English accent. And so I'd like to drop one of your own rhymes to you right now, if you don't mind.
Oh, you about to say an Ice-T
rhyme?
Drop
it, baby. Drop it.
Now, when you wine and dine a fox, don't take her to McDonald's or Jack in the Box. Don't pick her up in a bus or cab. Use your black belt, show for a corny track. There you go, guys. One from way back for you there, but thanks,
you
everyone.
You need a black belt chauffeur and a corniche rag. You know what I'm saying? I wanted my chauffeur to be able to fight like Bruce Lee. You dig what I'm saying? I was talking about cornices way back in the day, right? That's cool. Thank you for calling in, my man.
Hey, thanks for taking my call, man. Thanks.
Right, peace. Yo. I ain't never heard my lyrics spit that way. All right, we got Ice-T, Mobb Deep, and Mick Benzo on the line. Who's on the line?
This is Aaron from Marysville, Washington. Well, I just want to say, you and Mick Benzo are running the podcast as crazy up here in the Northwest. And we had a little tragedy here about 3 weeks ago. We had a school shooting. I don't know if you heard about it. So a kid went to school and started shooting a bunch of kids in the cafeteria. Just wanted to know what you thought about stuff like that compared to like when you grew up to where the kids are acting today when they can just get a gun and go shoot. He shot his girlfriend and like five of his best friends. Two of them were his cousins.
Havoc, Mobb Deep was speaking on. You heard?
Yeah, that's the kid that texted his friends and told them to meet him in the cafeteria, right?
Yeah, exactly. I'm from that town. I went to that high school.
Wow. It was in Washington.
You know, this shit is crazy. You know, like, I grew up in L.A. I grew up right at the heart of the gang banging and all that kind of stuff. And, I mean, honestly, you know, like, you know, when you got gangs, those are like two teams and they're opponents. And, they gonna clash at times, you know, and you kind of understand that. But just that random violence, like people doing crazy stuff, like, you know, going on even back to Columbine. That didn't really exist back in my day, you know, and now it's like the kid that you might not think he's violent is at the house making a pipe bomb. Like, shit is kind of escalated in a weird, bizarre way. I'm willing to believe that this kid wasn't what you would call a so-called bad kid up to that point. Am I correct?
No, he was a straight up good kid, sports kid. He was a prince prom queen the week before. You know, had to find honey and everything.
You know what it is? It's kids is under pressure right now, and they're under pressure in a different way, and these kids is lashing out. You know, like, we used to get bullied and stuff, and you might have to fight somebody that day or whatever, but now these kids is figuring out, no, the bully, I got the fully auto. We finna, like, you know, lay out every... It's just like that... The reaction, speak on it, bro.
It's crazy, man. It's definitely ill, man.
Right in my backyard, bro. Right in my backyard.
The different levels of violence and...
But you know what? The problem is this. People think guns are the problem. And it ain't the guns, because somebody wants to kill you will do it with a steak knife or something. It's a million ways to kill. It's just what's putting these people into this mind state to think that this is the answer. You dig? And I've been cornered in situations where I felt that my only solution was some type of, you know, real heavy violence and stuff. But it never got to that point. But I mean, it's crazy because in my life, and I think I lived a crazy life, I never wanted to murder multiple people. You know what I'm saying? It's like, I almost think that this is a coward move. I almost think that it's, you know, the tough guy will handle it differently. I think the coward, you know, they used to tell me that the most dangerous person is someone who's afraid of you. You know, because you got them scared, they figuring I got to kill him. So I really hate speaking on this stuff because people are dead and it's sad, but I really don't know what the solution is. I think you got to get into what has taken these kids to this point where they feel this is the solution.
One more question for you. For you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, on your new BC album, which is your favorite song to perform live?
Well, this is fucked up after the question, with the topic you just brought up.
So you have kind of fucked up, brother. You know what I mean?
Shit,
get shot.
Yeah, exactly.
I almost felt bad listening to the track the other day.
Yeah. But that record, you know, Body Count, yeah, my favorite record is Talk Shit, Get Shot. But that song is really more like based around internet bloggers and people that talk mess. And see, Body Count is what I call grindhouse. And if you know what grindhouse movies are, like, you know, Rodriguez makes, it's kind of like, it's over the top. So, you know, when the guy goes to the trunk, he don't pull out a gun, he pulls out a missile launcher. So body count is way, way over the top to the point where it's almost funny. You know, it's not meant to be taken seriously.
Love it 110%. We want more body count.
That's right. That's right. So you're not...
One more question.
No, three questions.
Is Mick Benzo there?
Yeah, Mick Benzo.
I need a dictionary from Mick Benzo.
What's happening, baby?
What's going on, Mick Benzo? I was wondering, you got your own dictionary, your own slang, right?
For sure.
Can we like buy your dictionary online?
Yeah, it's for sale. It's on iTunes, baby. I'm on iTunes.
The nigga just said Argentina, Canada. We lost that one. Yeah. But he's a motherfucker. But yeah.
Hey, man, we appreciate your call, man. Thanks for calling. Next caller.
Call
who's
all
this?
Day out 24/7. Thank you, Iceberg.
Peace. Next caller.
Who's on the line? We got Mobb Deep, Mick Benzo. What's happening? Who's here?
Yo, Ice, what's good? Mobb Deep, how we doing, fellas?
All right.
Where you calling from?
This is calling from Indiana. But the homeboy who called in earlier sparked my interest. I was going to ask you, fellas, you know, shit's crazy these days, right? So I stay strapped 24/7. I'm strapped all day long, right? I was going to ask you guys. I know you guys like guns.
No. Are you legal?
Is it legal where you are to carry guns?
It's legal.
I got a place in Arizona. You can carry concealed weapons in Arizona. Yeah, that shit's crazy.
Different laws in different states.
Yeah, I have a license. I have a license to carry a gun.
What kind of gun you carry?
Well, I carry a Walther PPK. It's a 380. I carry it in the shoulder holster just like James Bond did.
Why do you carry a gun?
I literally have a homeboy who made me a custom shoulder holster.
Okay, why you need to carry a weapon?
Why do you carry it?
You know, I like guns, so I carry a gun, and I like shooting guns. We were shooting guns earlier today at the range. And if someone wants to fuck with me, they're going to talk shit and get shot.
But we have a term in the streets too that we say some people don't need guns. And what that means is that sometimes something that might escalate to a fight because you got a gun will escalate to you shooting a motherfucker. I'm not fucking with people in Indiana because I know they strapped now.
No. You know, I was going to ask Mobb Deep, you know, how they wrote the Shook Ones Part 2, because first of all, that's the illest beat, and second of all, some of the illest verses, you know, I've ever heard. And I love hip hop, and that's, you know, I used to listen to that song every day for a portion, like my first, you know, couple of years of college. I love that track, and I was going to ask him, was it hard to write those verses? Did that come naturally? Like, you know, what was the thought process in writing that song? It's amazing.
I know the beat, making the beat, it came pretty natural to have. It had to, because he was about to trash the beat right before we caught him.
Right.
He was like, yo, nah, that beat, that ain't nothing. I'm like, nah, hold up, play that again. And that was Shook Ones. You know what I mean?
So, really?
Yeah.
Thank God.
Wow, so he was about to erase it to make room for some other shit he was working on.
8 Mile, because I'm a younger guy, I'm like 23. So when I heard that, I was like, man, I got to figure out what that song is.
Yeah, so when we wrote the lyrics to the song, basically it was just like, it just flowed real easy because the beat was so, you know, it just hit that spot. It was so like dark. It was just easy for the lyrics to come out.
The shit is too ill. I mean, that record right there, the shit, the intro, the first words, we got you stuck off the realness. It's like
the realness.
We be the infamous. You heard of us, official Queensbridge murderers. The mob comes prepared for warfare. It's
that.
You know what it is when you write classic shit. I bet that's your most quotable.
Probably.
I think most people can quote. I could quote that whole record. You know, mob comes prepared for warfare. Beware of a crime family who have nut shots to share for all those who want to profile and pose. Rock you in your face, stab your brain with your nose bone. Y'all alone in these streets, cousin. You know, my favorite shit is just, your crew is featherweight. My gunshots will make you levitate. I'm like, and this nigga says, as long as I'm alive, I'ma live illegal. I was like, what the fuck?
Mobb Deep.
Yeah, we ain't no.
Hey, you take care, man. Peace.
All right, bro.
Pleasure. Thanks, fellas.
All right, this was Final Level Podcast number 24 with the infamous Mobb Deep. Thanks for coming, guys. Right.
Thanks for having
us. We appreciate it, for real. Queens, y'all stand up, man. Y'all brothers are doing a great thing. And y'all still representing, man, because hip-hop ain't going to die. And we still here.
Ghetto entrepreneurs.
We here in our five boroughs. With the Knicks and the Nets and the Yankees and the Mets and the Giants and the Jets. Mobb Deep's in the building,
And that's what it is. You know, we had a good time. We're going to go out. What song are we going to go out on?
We're going to take them out with Taking You Off It.
Taking You Off It off the new album?
Yeah, off the new album.
Taking You Off It. This is Mobb Deep and Mick Benzo signing out. As like we always say, I'm out.
Tell a friend to tell a friend, goddammit. I'm out here like I stole something. See ya!
Yeah. Block the corridor, call the coroner. The drama's over, can't you feel the euphoria? Warrior, your cowards get cornier and cornier. We don't play games, never will we ever toy with you. Can't with you niggas, so my answer to niggas. Take you for a swim, throw his ass in the river, my lord. Y'all bitches all fraud to me though. Never banged out, we launched torpedo. Nigga still on paper, he reports to P.O. Then jump in the lamb and we off to the show. Play my cards right, never go see a hoe. Or catch me in the crib, compromise like, oh shit. Bitch, what you got me into? My goons will be here with the medical utensils like pop, 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 pop. You don't hear screams or you hear them shots. Taking you off it, say he gotta get got. Nigga violated, so he gotta get got. Fascinate niggas, get your body that shot. Handle that shit off top. Taking you off it, said he gotta get got. Nigga violated, so he gotta get got. Fascinate niggas, get your body that shot. Handle that shit off top. Look, I'm taking you off
here. Don't bring scared business around me. Nigga bleed just like us. I flood the cold street with your hot blood. Was mad night steaming. Your soul in limbo. Right there on the cement. The ghost of a bitch ass nigga. Casper, nigga, I'm the worst demon you could ever ask for. Don't conjure me up. You burn in hell like I put a bomb to your truck. Insidious when I creep on a nigga nuff. Machine got breathed that gunpowder lungs. Powerball money off rap. Basking in the lime green light. Come and get your ass whipped. On cameras, there's no tapping out on that concrete canvas. We don't do the body locks. Fuck a sleeper hole, you sleepy from a headshot. My gun don't premature nut. It busts at the exact time it's supposed to bust.
Taking you off it, say he gotta get got. Nigga violated, so he gotta get got. Fascinate niggas, get your body that shot. Handle that shit off top. Taking you off it, say he gotta get got. Nigga violated, so he gotta get got. Fascinate niggas, get your body that shot. Handle that shit off top. I'm taking you off it. Say he gotta get got. Nigga violated, so he gotta get got. Fascinate niggas, get your body that shot. Handle that shit off top. Taking you off it. Say he gotta get got. Nigga violated, so he gotta get got. Fascinate niggas, get your body that shot. Handle that shit off top. I'm taking you off it.
That's how I'm living.